agile and scaling. So as I elaborated in an initial stage, the first discussion we need to do is what is agile, and subsequently we need to talk about how we make it scale. Okay.
So not
how is next? Okay. What are the challenges is to be able to scale? Thanks for pointing that out. How will be the next part? Okay. So anybody wants to take this part of session? Facilitate. This should be easy. Why is agile? Because many people will be talking.
We already discussed quite a bit of
it. Okay, so let me do this particular one. So we make some momentum and then we will have a tea break. So good part is this. Okay. So after this we will take a tea break. So what is agile? Quickly. Yeah, go ahead.
Agile is a methodology. Its main purpose is to adapt capability at any moment.
How many of you oppose it? Three. Okay. How many of four? How many of you support him? Other than neutral, eh? So how many of you are supporting him? No support, only opposition you got, yeah. Okay, somebody opposing him, tell his point.
So you know, agile is not a methodology, agile is basically
the
set of principles, it's basically agile is conceptual. Agile tells you how or you know what agile basically tells you why the principles basically, which are you know very universal. The methodology then take these principles and try to form practices as to how we can deliver those principles. So Scrum is a methodology, Kanban is a methodology, Stream programming is a methodology. You have them in a
So do you agree or you want to change your statement?
No.
You don't want to change your statement. Okay.
Because I read somewhere that
read somewhere is the bigger problem. Okay.
Somewhere means in a means I think on a Scrum and Agile, right?
Okay.
Agile is a methodology.
Okay. Now now there is a confusion. Since you went to a Scrum and Agile website, they will talk about Scrum. And it has been a problem with even Scrum also. So when Jeff Sutherland wrote the recent book that doing double the work in half the time, he said that we are no more a methodology, we are a framework. So that's the second debate that Scrum is a framework or Scrum is a methodology. But yes, Scrum Alliance website does talks about that Scrum is the most popular methodology of Agile. Yeah. So but again, it goes with the Webhouse point. They are talking about Scrum is the most popular methodology of Agile. Many times they define Scrum. Scrum is the most popular process of implementing Agile. So we can think of like the Webhouse presented. It's just the values and principles which talks about why or where you want to go. Now how part is not given. So it's just the goals are given that we want to do something like this. Some hints that this is something you can do to reach there, but not a detailed steps of reaching there. And those are the ones which are coming from various methods. And many times we believe Agile is something which came first and then people figured out how to do it. But the story is reverse. Yeah. So there were methods before, people were figuring out doing things, and then they agreed on common values and principles. So it's like Scrum was in existence before Agile came into the picture. Agile got into 2001 only when the Agile Manifesto got written. Great. So statement from Agile Manifesto. Four statements. Can somebody recall first statement?
Individual and interaction over process and tools.
So individual and interaction over
process and tools.
Second.
Collaboration over contract negotiation.
Exactly.
That was third one. Working software over.
Comprehensive documentation. Great. And third is customer collaboration over contract negotiation. Fourth,
responding to change over
following the plan. So if you have to define Agile, you just need to talk about these four things. This does the Agile. Now these principles are these values are at a bigger higher level. Then they elaborate further by way of 12 principles. So let's look at these 12 principles and figure it out. Can we scale them or do we have challenges in scaling them? Okay, and challenges maybe we can write on stickies because we need to preserve them. Yeah. So challenges something we can write them into. You may use a different color and the challenges, then the possible solutions, and then the practices. So we need four colors, like three colors.
Challenges.
Challenges, then possible solutions.
Mm,
next story, and then finally mapping to the practice. Okay. So, 12 principles. Our highest priority is to satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of working software, or valuable software. What does it mean?
It means at the end of the sprint, we need something delivered that is working.
Yeah, if we are not seeing end of the sprint. Yes, but yes, you can think of that when we implement Scrum, this becomes like this, that at the end of sprint, we should have a potentially shippable product increment. Okay, and the principle is saying that you should be always focusing on potentially shippable product increment, or you should be focusing on product increment or a shippable product increment. That should be your primary focus. Now, many times we think of that always have been a focus, but no, you don't know. Many organization metrics are primarily focused on how many hours the developer was working, how many hours the tester was working, how many bugs the person has raised. And a lot of times they give importance to those metrics more than working software. So it looks too general, but yes, if you get into a process history, it was not that obvious. So having said that, can we scale this? Even if you work with 100 people, so I'm talking about scaling definition where we are working with more than 9 people, we have a good number of people working, can you still produce a working software? Or can you still give a value? I'm not saying produce. Can you still give a maximum value to a working software?
Yes.
No issue? Yeah. So this is something, a philosophy. Even if you have 100 people, you should be scaling this. Agreed?
Sir, There will be a challenge. Because now what happens is the size of the scope of your product is too big.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's not always possible to even divide them into basic stories or something. If you manage to divide them, the amount of stories that you get done, you know, in your sprint duration, I'm talking about sprint duration or you know, whatever time you're devoting to come up with that incremental software, is it might not be sufficient to produce a functional thing all across.
So what I get from your discussion is that since there is a good number of people there,
yes,
it would be difficult to integrate or have,
yes,
integrated working software frequently.
Yes.
It may take time.
Yes.
Yeah. So we will have another principle which gets into detail of it. This principle is primarily saying that should we keep giving value to the working software the most?
Yep.
So basically what we are saying is this particular principle still important when you are talking about,
yes,
skilled agility?
Because in some principles are just talking about principle, few give a hint towards practice. For example, the backup point was that we can't give that frequently. So there was another principle which says that we should deliver working software frequently from couple of weeks to couple of months. So we can have that discussion during that principle. Okay, here's this value. Yeah? Great. So we have an agreement. We are moving it here, and no, we don't feel any challenge as of now because it's just about value. So our highest priority, we should keep giving priority to working software. Yeah, it may not come in 2 weeks, it may come in 2 months. Yeah, but still the priority is there. Welcoming changing requirement even late in development process, agile process harness change for customer competitive advantage. Keep allowing changes in your process frequently without worrying about if there is a customer competitive advantage. So that word we usually miss, you know. We think that agile is all about change, but we should be doing change for the customer's competitive advantage. It's not like just change. So can we scale this thing? Can we work with 100 people and still we keep focusing on changing things?
Yes. Because we also have the principle of time boxing. So as long as we have time box what we are working upon, the rest of the thing is
still can be changed.
I mean, it can be changed. It's volatile any which way. So as long as we have not picked up something, it's not an active development or an active progress. Yeah, bye.
So what I take from Webber's point is, if I extrapolate it, he's saying that since we are not elaborating the complete requirement, complete design upfront, we are always doing progressively at last responsible movement. There is a part of the project or part of the solution which we have not yet worked on, and if you want to change it, change it. Yeah, we still work on a cadence or in a time box kind of a rhythm, and we can allow that particular change. So that is where we say. Any other opinion about it?
I think we have to value that principle. If we don't value this principle of responding to change, we are not agile enough, right? Then we are not talking about agile.
True. But what I'm talking about is that one is you have a small car and another is you have a big truck. So there should be a different definition of change for a car and a truck when you want to change the route while driving. Because here you are heavy, you are 100 people, you are more than. Well, you have some inertia. You have some gravity.
There could be a side effect that it might take more time, but if there's a sharp turn coming, you have to turn. Mm-hmm. Like that, right? That is a car, that's a truck. If there's a sharp turn coming, you can't afford to go off the road. You still have to turn. It might you have to slow down speed further, you know, it might take more time, that's a different thing.
Yeah, so that is the point I was trying to drive. The point Gabor made, I have no disagreement with it. I was only trying to find out that since we are big, can we change that easily as we used to change when we were smaller?
It's tough, but it will take much time. More time.
I said no. I mean, it should be still that, because that's what the beauty of principles are. They are universal. I mean, we can't say that, you know, it's easy to be an honest organization if we are 10 people, but it's okay to allow cheating and be a corrupt organization if we are 100 people. So, you know, no excuse in my humble opinion is good enough or strong enough to deviate from principles. So, if we were finding it easy to change, you know, when we are size of 9, but difficult to change when we are size of 50, I think we missed something somewhere during expansion. Maybe our practices got corrupted or, you know, something of that sort.
Okay. So, if I take it further, the changes which is done in a bigger environment may require more coordination effort, because your change may impact someone else also. And if you are only a single team, you can decide that you want to change this particular user story or you want to change the design, you can do it. But if you have another 8 teams which are also relying on your piece of code, then you may need to follow some way to coordinate, communicate. Yeah, at a principal level it is true. At this principal level it is true. But it may bring challenges when you implement this principle in a bigger scale.
Yeah, absolutely. So the overhead of communication and coordination both is gonna be.
So that is what I wanted to drive, is can we have a challenge sticky out of it? Can you want to do something?
Yes, what probably, you know, when we do that, how part of this is.
So how is the solution?
Yeah,
the challenge part of it.
Yeah, fair enough. So what I'm trying to say is this challenge has to be addressed at that point of time.
Yes.
Absolutely. See, fundamentally, if you see any principle should be scalable if you really see. Otherwise, that's not a principle. You can't call it as
true.
So the definition of a principle is that it should be, if it works for 5, it should work for 100, and it should work for 1 million. But the point is, I think more due weightage should be given while we are discussing about the how part.
Yes.
So let's take it as a challenge that, you know, change
great.
Is not easy when you scale this particular principle.
True. So definitely we can scale it, but yeah, there is something challenges which we need to take care of. Did you have been working software from couple of weeks to couple of months? Preference to a shorter time scales. Now that the challenge which we discussed with when we were talking about the first principle is that with, so we can re-talk about it. What I got is that with scale, there will be a more effort needed for integration, dependency management, which may increase your delivery time, or say increase your frequency of delivering working software. Means in a smaller scale, you may keep delivering working software, say every 2 weeks, but in a bigger scale, that is what I can gather from the previous discussion, it may require some more time. So that is what you wanted to say, Vaibhav?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what is the challenge here? Why?
Because point is, now we have a bigger project, and
okay.
We have got independent modules, individual modules per se. These will be still easy to, you know, deliver working software as well as these individual modules are concerned. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to integration, when it comes to, you know, working software as a complete piece of software, that integration part throws in its own set of challenges. Okay, you know, I mean, we We have all been in situations where something is working fine on my machine, but when I integrate it with the server, you know, where other people have checked in their code, it stops working. There are issues.
Integration. Challenge to integration. So we have we have two challenges sticking up. One is responding to change, extra overhead for communication and coordination. Okay, and then we are talking about integration. So integration becomes challenging when we have a multiple people, multiple code base working on it. True?
Yeah.
Communication as well.
Okay.
Another challenge is
coordination.
Another fundamental issue which comes while scaling is probably, I'm not sure if it ties back right directly to this principle, but is, see, what Agile really told us, remove a lot of layers in between and bring collaboration, bring one team, one place and everything. And that's the reason you get your potential maximized. The moment you start scaling is where you have to put a lot of layers in order to get the communication in there. And that's where the problem starts. So probably, you know, scaling puts you in a position to again go back to a model where you are starting introducing a lot of layers. So it could be in terms of people, it could be in terms of code, as you said, you know, doing integration, it could be in terms of documenting that how do this team is developing, this team is developing, how do I merge these two documents?
Productivity goes down.
Absolutely.
So we can say that if we were having 5 people, we were doing 50 story point. If we have 10 people, we may not be able to do 100 story point.
Absolutely.
So, because the cost of coordination, communication, overheads will be there.
Absolutely.
Right? Challenge. So, overhead challenge. Overhead is another one. So, the challenge is how to maintain productivity with scaling. So that's the challenge. So challenge, we can think of the solutions, or we can agree to that there is no solution to it. But the challenge is that how to ensure that even if when we are growing faster or we are adding more people, we earn more money. Yeah? So I keep telling my company people that I want to monitor revenue per employee. If I add one more employee, the revenue should move in the same proportion. So that is what makes us real scalable rather than just adding people and not earning more.
I mean, more than the productivity, I would say that you know, the issue with how to deliver working software when there are multiple teams, you know, working. Because with multiple teams, whether you like it or not, as much as you can share the floor space or as much as you can have, you know, shared tools and everything, the silos come into picture. I mean, that's the nature of it, right? So, the challenge that is basically how to produce working software when, you know, you have multiple teams.
Integration issue or like
I think it's a basic dependency issue.
How to manage dependencies?
Yes.
Challenge. So people will have their dependency could be technical, dependency could be requirement, dependency could be of any type. So we will face. So the idea of this is just bringing up the challenges.
Yeah.
So it's not necessary that we focus on values. Values is a way of extracting those challenges.
So as you know, Gaurav said, dependencies, because we still have a common product backlog. You know, it's not that team A is working on a different product backlog, B is working on a different backlog, and so on and so forth. So when you have dependencies among stories, and you know, team A is taking up story A, which needs to be done before team B can complete B, and you know, another could be B is needs to work on story C, whereas team can only work on story D if you know C gets completed. So we might have this potential deadlock situations and you know, things like that.
In fact, it ties back to the change part as well.
No, so the moment you change, and again, the dependency goes for a task.
Great. So, we spoke about many challenges which is coming from driving and delivering working software. Business people and developer must work together daily throughout the project.
And so, are we saying this is not scalable?
It is, we are saying it will depend. So, again, principle SLA is always scalable. The idea is just to extract challenges option. So, yes. Business people and developer must work together. Don't forget the name daily. So Agile Manifesto puts a clear term that you people should work together daily with the business people. Business people could be a product owner, could be a whoever is somebody who represents the business dimension to the customer, to the development team. They should work together daily. Can we have it in a scaled environment?
We
what would you have a challenge?
We have different levels of it. For each individual team, you would still have a product owner, but to a higher level, that coordination is...
That's a solution. It's a solution. So the idea is that why Scrum focused on one product backlog? Again, the Chinese whisper or communication gap and transparency and all those things were the reason behind keeping things centralized. So in Scrum, there was a very stringent mandate that keep one person, a real one person, named person, who gives you a requirement. We don't want to have any confusion. And this named person, be it extreme programming and Scrum, should be always available to give the guidance, declare the details to the team. So that is like, they should work together daily. There should be a daily interaction between these things. Do we see some challenge here when we want to talk about scaling?
Yeah, because the number is huge. The tight collaboration or meeting may not be possible.
So maybe raising
what Sanjay has said, one PO might is good enough for one team, maybe two teams, but beyond that, having just one PO might be a stretch.
So the challenge is that one PO may be difficult to manage, but if you bring multiple PO...
One PO might not be sufficient. After all, there's just 8 or 12 hours in a day. We can fine-tune them with some practices, some intelligent solutions, but beyond that, he can't stretch his day.
And if you bring multiple people, then there will be communication issues.
Then there is a communication.
So challenge...
Knowledge
issues as well, because everybody will not be looking at the same thing in the same way.
Especially when teams are distributed.
So the two challenges coming, keeping one product owner or one business person is not feasible in a scaled environment. That is because the person may not be able to tell or help to 8, 9 team. The second challenge is if we have multiple people doing it, then there will be a communication gap and knowledge issues. So two challenges, and both are contradicting each other. One, we are saying that we can't do it with one. The other is that if we bring many, again there is a problem.
So if I understand this properly, this is one principle. I can't even say it depends really.
I'm struggling to.
True.
So again, it depends. Let's say it depends on the size of the team, on the complexity of the project. The way many companies or many teams addresses that, they give a lot of focus on sprint zeros. So it's not just one sprint zero, they take the entire 1 month to thrash a good enough part of product backlog beforehand.
True. So we will talk about the solutions.
Let's
select the challenges first, and we will have enough time to figure it out the solutions of it. Great. So I am putting it dependent and moving it forward. Build people around motivated individuals, give them environment and support they need, and trust them to get the job done. Any issue with when you have a small company or a big company or a small team or a bigger team in implementing this? So it's like build a project around motivated individuals. Trust them and they will get the job done.
I think that is good.
So nothing specific, it is only about trusting people. Lean keeps talking about respect people. So the lean, if you look at a lean house, it has a one pillar which talks about respect people. So people are not the problem. They want to work, just give them a good processes, good way of doing things, they will do great. So I think this is a too generic thing, so we can...
I have an opinion here.
Yeah, please.
This is always the 80-20 rule. And the moment you start scaling, environment is good. We all get good environments. That's the reason we are working for a company. But that 80-20 rule really prevails that, no matter what you do, the moment you have a team of 8 or 10 versus you have 100, you know that 20% is your, but the environment was the same for everyone. So that is something I don't know how do we address while scaling. You can't keep every individual motivated, no matter what you do. Let's be honest.
But that is a problem for the non-scale team as well. So it is a problem for a small team as well as for a big team. So it is more like a behavioral organization problem, less to coming with the scaling. And maybe in a case of a scaling, if you have this problem, the problem is scaling. So if you have a problem in a smaller team, it will scale it up. The presentation yesterday I was making, it keeps saying that we need to scale agile. We don't have to scale the dysfunction of our team. which is already dysfunctioning, and we just scale it into a bigger dysfunction. So let's not scale the dysfunction, scale the agile.
Dysfunction most likely will scale linearly.
The dysfunction will scale linearly. Great, so we will talk, if do we have a challenge here? Maybe the people will lose the human touch, so they can't create that kind of a peer pressure or something, the way it can be done in a smaller team.
Not really.
For example, like you are sitting in a one room, so you know each other well.
There have been companies where it's like you have to focus on your culture. You know where you are focusing on. If, let's say, as a owner or the director of the ship, or you know, the captain of the ship, if your focus suddenly changes to profits or suddenly changes to something else, then this will suffer anyway. You will start suffering here with 9 people. But if your focus is core culture, core values, and you know, staying honest to your principles, I think this can be managed. I mean, I don't know whether you know this about, but there's this company called 37 Signals. They have this close to 40 people, and most of them are either working from home or working from other countries. The only regulation, the only compulsion that they have is that you have to get together once in a week for a 2-hour meeting. If you can come in the office, great. If you can't, attend it from wherever you are. But apart from that, they are free to work, and they still have maintained their culture. They have,
like you are saying, the co-location point and scaling and distributed thing. The point which we were talking about here is that is the motivational part has something to do with number of people. That is the only thing we were talking about. That if you are a small team, does that help to get some kick for a motivation? If you become a bit bigger, that may bring some level of identity crisis that nobody wants.
So, yeah, of course. I mean, the point is the idea that we want to have a motivated workforce. Okay. You know, things that we were doing, which were working for a 9 people team, will not work for a 30 people. So, as let's say, you know, if I'm the owner of the company, or if I'm the owner, I mean, if I'm the one who's responsible for motivation, so I have to realize that, you know, I can't use the same tactics, same principles, same practices which I was using to motivate 9 people. I need to change.
So that's the point. Yeah. So that's the point we wanted to try. So we have a challenge, and then we will have some solutions which takes this part to a bigger level. Like bring some kind of ceremonies or events where people can feel as a one team, even if they are bigger.
The challenge here will be alignment. It will be difficult to keep the entire team aligned to the bigger object, the system view, right? With a small team, it's easy for each person to have whole system view. With a bigger team, where you have like 50 people and each one is focused on one set of functionality or sub-functionality of the entire system. So when you lose that alignment with the higher objective, then the motivation generally comes down.
So let's take two challenges. One is that alignment issue, and the second one is the closeness, the communication openness which exists into a smaller team may not be directly transferable to a bigger team. So we need to figure it out how to do it.
One more aspect I have on to this. Suggest that even Agile also says that let's work in a team, promote your team rather than individual. We always say that, and that's a very nice principle to have. But the moment you get into a scaling part of it, right, see, individual aspirations also come into picture, and everybody wants recognition. Right? And the moment you are scaling, probably you are always limited to a smaller team because that's how you are going to scale. So individual aspirations also somewhere gets, you know, because of the principles of aid, then you have to promote the team. And moreover, you know, Scrum doesn't believe in, individuals to be given awards and things like that. So that is something, you know, probably I don't know how to handle when, you know, if you're scaling, or probably is that a challenge or not? I see that as a challenge sometimes that, you know, when you are doing for a 100 people team, how do you do that?
Individual recognitions.
Recognitions.
And
inspirations as well.
Inspirations. So maybe second part will be that the motivation to give a coverage to it. Great, so we are a bit late, so we need to bit fast now. Most efficient and effective method of conveying information is face-to-face interaction. What kind of challenges do you see in scaling this?
It's impractical to have face-to-face conversation across all people.
Most efficient and effective conveying information is face-to-face conversation. So, do we have a challenge in case of a scale?
Yeah.
We can't have a co-located team in most of the time. So what to do when we don't have a co-located team? Even in a normal safe or a scrum also we had this challenge. But if many people and they don't have a face-to-face conversation, it can create some chaos. So we need to think out something here, that what do we do to make it scale or make it happen. Working software is the primary measurement of progress. No issue. We can still, the same point, the first point we have discussed. So it still makes sense. Agile process promotes sustainable development. No overwork. Their sponsor, developer, team should be able to maintain a constant pace for indefinite point. It's more like a principle. So sustainable pace, nobody working overtime, nobody working under time, you're working on a rhythm and that is how you do things. Make sense? Yeah, irrespective of scaling or not scaling. Continuous attention to technical excellence and good designs enhance agility. Continuous attention to technical excellence and good design enhance agility. It's a principle.
Yeah, I mean,
do you see challenge here?
It's the same communication coordination.
Do we see a challenge that people following different coding practices, different way of writing, because we talk about shared code base, continuous refactoring, anybody can modify anywhere in the product. Do we feel challenges there?
Yes, absolutely. With a bigger team of 50 to 100, it will definitely become...
So what could be the challenge statement? So maintaining a code? So we can say that coding rule. Yeah, go ahead, go ahead.
I think the challenge could be ensuring that focuses on the design for them and not just the principle.
Continuous attention to technical
excellence. So ensuring that there is actually continuous attention to the design. See, because point is, let's say when you are a team of 9 people, you all are sitting here. So, you pretty much have an idea of who is doing what and what is doing not. You can see on what is said, whether he's working on code or whether he's watching YouTube or he's slacking off or something of that sort. But let's say if you have a team in another room, it becomes difficult to, I'm taking that as an example, it becomes difficult to that. So challenge here is ensuring that there is continuous attention.
Yeah. So ensuring that we follow coding rules, we follow good design practices without having a co-located team. So because in a small team, since it is a co-located, it kind of automatically get ensured, because you are working in the same environment. But when you have a bigger team, how to bring coding practices in place, how to ensure that team is following coding practices which can make the complete code base maintained. It could be, solution could be a configuration management, solution could be a clear coding rules, solution could be a pair programming or shifting people from one team to another team. So there could be multiple solutions which we can think of, but yeah.
Sometimes the same Scrum team can be also distributed globally.
And then also you have this problem.
Yes.
Yeah. And but when you have a multiple team which are again distributed, then think of the scale of the problem.
Yes.
So
nowadays there is a term called technical debt. So how to keep it minimal is what the challenge is, biggest challenge is with scaling.
Okay. So how to control technical debt?
Yes.
Just write it as a So that will become another challenge. Great. So we will talk. It is something like it is seriously looked into. And just for an advance information, no scaling can happen till the time you have a good technical practices in place. And none of the framework undermines the importance of technical practices. And many times I find in organizations it's the least discussed topic. People don't even talk about it because they take it granted that technical practices to acha hoga hi. And that is a real challenge in the market as of now. Okay, simplicity, the art of maximizing the amount of work not done is essential. Again, it's a philosophy. It just keeps talking about that prioritize your work continuously. Do the only things which give the maximum value. Don't get into the detail of each and everything. So it is a philosophy. I guess it is just scary. Best architecture and design emerges from self-organizing teams. So that DevOps point which we were talking about, since you have 5-6 people working in a one group, whenever they want to make design, they can have a discussion and they can refine it. But when you have most people, 99% they would not be sitting in a one room. Even if they sit in a one room, you can't talk to them in a way you were talking to 9 people. So what do you do with it? Like, how can you ensure that best architectural requirement and design emerges from self-organizing team?
Cross-team collaboration.
Challenge. So what is the challenge?
Cross-team collaboration.
It's a solution, you know.
That's a challenge. You have to ensure that they collaborate across teams. Within a team, it's easier. You know, if they are following Scrum or whichever practice they're following, within 5 to 9 members, it's very optimal.
So I can see 2 points here. One, he says that how to create a self-organizing team of teams.
Yeah.
But like you have a one team which is self-organized, but how to create a self-organized teams of teams, which is a one challenge. The another challenge is, can we leave a technical architecture or design on just self-organizing team of teams? Or do we need some proactive approach to take care of it? So do we have a challenge there? Like, can we leave, do we see a problem if we just leave a technical design, etc., to self-organizing teams?
Yes.
Challenge.
I mean, challenge is, you see the point as, once again, you need to have some governance, some regulation in place. Again, just to give you an example, let's say, you know, if there is no red light, if the red light is not working, even if we all are honest citizens, we want to follow traffic rules, we like to take our chance. You know, let's jump it, let's try to see it. Even if red light is working, we'll try to see a chance. If there's low traffic, if there's not something coming, it's safe, let's do that. But if traffic constable is standing, or even if a person is standing in white shirt and, you know, dark blue trousers,
we just
wait. You know, we are cautious and we don't want to do.
So even I keep observing these things and keep mapping to Agile. See, you don't need red light if you have a self-organizing team, but it cannot go for 100 cars. It can go for 2-3 cars. When you have a road, there is not that much traffic. In midnight, even red light will not operate, because they know that there are not many people and they can just self-organize themselves. We don't have to instruct them. But as your traffic increases, you can't just leave on them. It can't self-organize anymore. So the same way, when you scale, you need to have such kind of mechanism which gives a direction, which gives some
guiding
thing, which helps us in organizing. So what is the challenge here? That we need to have a solution again. Okay? So how to create a self-organizing team of teams is the one challenge, and how to ensure the design and architectural practices alignment. Cover
one challenge is having the best practices and technical excellence we talked about. The thing is having consistency. When there are so many teams, having a consistent feel of the design. All of us have come across some code which was written by 4 programmers in 4 different ways, and you go there and try to maintain that code, it's
difficult. Great. So we will talk about it. It is something more. At regular interval, the team reflect on how to become more effective and tune their adjustments. So retrospective. So we can scale retrospective. It's just the way of looking at things. If you don't retrospect, nothing will work. Because whatever you decide, whatever framework you put in a place, it will become obsolete. And I have seen many good initiatives at personal level, at professional level, at organizational levels, failing when you don't take stock of it frequently. You can think of making a big, good body, attend a 2-day workshop on how to make muscle, but it doesn't work. And unless you take feedback in account and do it the regular thing, because one workshop will not solve the problem.
So the challenge I see here,
yeah.
And I really completely agree, this is one of the most important things that your organization should do, with the true spirit as well. But the challenge I see is that not every way of doing the retrospection will work when you scale.
Okay.
Something which works for a 9-people team is not going to work when you want to get it for 100 people. There has to be a different way of doing things when the moment you scale.
Right.
So probably that is what the challenge is, what to fit where.
Challenge.
You know?
So how to make a learning big group, like how to make a group, a bigger group, to retrospect on their behavior and interdependencies.
Yes.
So you can retrospect in a group and talk about what is going wrong with us, but then you also need to know what is going wrong in a different team, or how that something going wrong in a different team impacts you. So what kind of we are facing a challenge to have a group level retrospective, you can think of.
We'll talk about scaling retrospective.
Yeah, scaling retrospective.
Yes.
So how to scale retrospective?
The topic which
you have. about a talk in our Discuss Agile conference. Mohit has proposed a topic which is talking about how to scale retrospective. Great. So we deep dive karna hai. And the idea as a definition of Doug of this story was that we looked at the Agile principles and then we came up with a challenge. Now just to before I close this particular story, also look at that these principles were coming and we were just looking at one dimension of Agile principle. When we think of a solution, also think of Agile framework or a Scrum framework. For example, you are starting with a sprint planning meeting, or you are starting with a product backlog and you are selecting some set of user stories for it in your sprint planning meeting, and then you are doing daily setup. Finally, you are doing review, and finally you are doing retro, and this is giving potentially shippable product increment. Now, when we take a tea break, we can think of more challenges. So individual can think of more challenges and write on a sticky note of a pink, which is more towards coming of how do we manage this backlog in a scaled environment? How do we do sprint planning? Do you see a problem in doing sprint planning when you have multiple teams doing it? Again, pointing to this thing, or you may have a separate product backlogs. They are doing daily stand-ups. Do you think there is a challenge in something doing daily stand-up? For a review, can you have an integrated product demo? Or you want to give an individual demos? If you give an individual demo, then who gives the integrated demo? How the integrated demo happens? And who ensures that learning is done in a various retrospective, get feeded back to complete this, say, 80 people team? Just take a simple number for a reference. So during the tea, think about this aspect as well. It may bring up some challenges, which we want to put here, so that when we think of a scaling solution, we can think of all of these things. Make sense? The story is not over. We are just taking a pause.